The scenario to be played is destruction. It has a 12 by 6 rectangle placed in the middle of the board. It has the kill box in effect. You will then also place two objectives on opposite corners. You get 1 point for destroying or removing from play your opponent's objective. You get one control point for controlling the zone and two for dominating. First person to 5 points wins the game.
Greetings, this is Iron Lich W, and this week I am playing Asphyxius 3. My opponent Snarky challenged Asphyxius 3 to his Asphyxius 2 list, and I accepted. One thing I know off the bat is that my list will be outnumbered, however I will have heavier units on the table with the Bane Riders and the two Heavy Jacks. So I gotta try and maximize the damage output that I can harness with those guys, as well as kill as many guys as possible, since I know he's gonna, at some point in time, he's gonna have to bunch up his army.
So I decided to take Lich Lord Asphyxius, or as I like to call him, Epic Lich. Let's be honest, there's only one true Lich in the Nightmare Empire, and we all know who that is. His battle group is composed of a Helldiver and Death Ripper. For units, I decided to take a maximum unit of Bane Knights, a maximum unit of Bane Thralls with Officer and Standard, a minimum unit of the Satixis Blood Witches with the Hag, a minimum unit of Bile Thralls, and the Wither Shadow Combine. For solos, I'm taking Derek Wraith, Bane Lord Tartarus, and a pair of Warwitch Sirens. So when I think about deployment, usually the first thing that comes to mind is what scenario are we playing? And, you know, we're playing Destruction right now, which is a very central scenario. It's actually pretty easily to win if you're able to jam the zone and get an early dominate, and that's something that I think Gatsby really excels at, so I'm going to be playing this game with that in mind. Next, I really look at the terrain involved. On my left-hand side, we have Deepwater, which is basically a no-fly zone for any of my infantry and any warjacks, too. So I'm treating that almost as an obstruction, since, you know, it's cricks on cricks and none of us really have a lot of shooting. On my right side, there's a forest, and usually when there's a forest on my side of the table, I use that for my Bane Knights. Basically, the rationale here is that the Bane Knights can hide behind the forest, and if, you know, just out of line of sight, while keeping a few maybe within that 3 inches, and if one of them dies, the rest of them can vengeance forward to retaliate on everything else. Keeping my Bane Thralls in the middle of the table for easy access to kill jacks and anything that's contesting the zone, and then I have my Blood Witches on the left-hand side, just because I don't think they're going to play a huge factor in this matchup, so I'll just use them to kind of maybe jam up the Satixis Raiders a little bit. I've also put my Bio Thralls in the middle of the table so I can maximize any Excarnate range, and then my Solars are kind of just put on that left side just because I have less troops there, so they're going to play a support role to clean that zone out over there if need be.
For deployment of the Asphyxius 3 list, I started by putting Asphyxius in the middle, Vociferant to the right, Reaper directly to the left, and then have the Bane Riders on my far left flank, since they will be able to mitigate the forest on the opponent's side of the board. I go ahead and put Ornn Midwinter kind of near the middle and behind the army with the Bokor and Gorman right next to him. For advanced deploy, I start by putting Deathjack on the slightly to the left of the center on the hill, but right next to the hill. Kinkworm near the center, then the Satixis on the far right flank in the forest, so they start off with concealment.
So turn one is actually usually pretty boring for Krix players. I mean, without a lot of shooting, you know, really we're just trying to run screaming across the table as fast as we can. And as you'll see, I kind of positioned myself to do just that. Right now, Gatsby's moving forward. He's going to spend 3 to put up Hellbound on him. I like getting that out early because the Wither Shadow Combine can upkeep that for free. Next, he's putting out a few clouds, and I'm not really worried about blocking line of sight with these clouds. I'm more worried about basically ensuring that the Satixis Raiders can't jam the zone. After that, I'm moving up my Wart Siren to power boost my Arc Node, and I'm moving my Arc Node in a threatened position. On second thought, I decide to put it behind the wall for a little bit of cover just to make sure that he doesn't Hex Blast the Arc Node out of it. Next, I'm moving the Bane Knights, and you know, like I said, what I like to do is I like to position most of them behind the forest. It's kind of so for turn two, you know, maybe I can put one or two of them in the forest within line of sight to get those Vengeance going. The Helldiver is pretty standard. He's going to burrow each turn unless my opponent gives me an opportunity to knock down his caster. The Bane Thralls, I'm really just trying to get them as far up the table as I can right now. Again, they're centralized just so they can deal with, you know, any of the armor that he puts forward into the zone over the next couple turns. Next we have the Biothralls. These I'm moving up as far as I can, and you know, really what I'm going to be looking for is I'm going to be looking for a good Excarnate on his Satixis Raiders. I have the Arc Node to the left, I have the Biothralls in a menacing position. If I can get a great Excarnate that takes out half of the unit and gives me a bunch of souls, you know, that's really good for me. Derek Rafe's moving right now, he's doing Death Ride, so I'm getting one extra inch of threat range for all of my undead models. And usually I'll use Death Ride the first turn, and then after that, most likely I'll be on death with Derek Rafe, just to give myself the little armor bump. In the Crix vs. Crix matchup, it's not as big of a deal because most of my opponent's stuff is undead, but if I was facing Hordes, it's most always beyond death at that point. Now he's just like Kevin away. Next, I'm moving up my Satixis Blood Witches. They're really just going to jam as hard as they can, so I'm moving them in a position to where if he tries to move some of his Satixis Raiders between the deep water and my clouds, I can charge them with the gang bonus next turn, take a few out, and then mini feet in defense. Lastly, you'll see that I'm just moving my Satixis Raider, I'm moving my Ward Siren into a position that's very central.
For Sixius turn 3, I am beginning to think that I'm going to try and start picking off the Blood Witches first, then Bane Thralls, then Bane Knights. I'm going to try and save Bane Knights for later in the game, that way I'm not giving him Vengeance and getting them to my lines faster. I go ahead and allocate one point of focus out to the Reaper, just because I know he's going to have run. And I start by activating the Sixius Raiders. I have them just advance to the edge of the forest. I don't need to run them all the way out there. They're already within charge range of the enemy objective. So I just want to have them hang out until my second turn in which they can charge the enemy objective. Activate the Raider, bring her close to formation with the rest, or the Raider Captain, and bring her to formation with the rest of the Raiders. Then I'm starting to measure out. I'm thinking if I run Vociferin up, I can Arc, Hex Blast, and kill a few of the Blood Witches because they look like they're kind of close together. So I end up running Vociferin up there. And then I have Cankerworm advance just in case my opponent puts clouds in front of the objective. He'll be able to take the point of damage, get in there, and kill the objective. Run the Boar Core up. He's a little expendable. He's a bit expendable this game because my opponent doesn't really have any shooting. Then I go ahead and advance Asphyxius. He casts Ashen Bale through Vociferin onto the Raiders, just to give him, not really for the concealment, but for the -2 to enemy attack rolls of enemy living models later in the game. And then I do some more measuring, and I decide to go ahead and chance it with a Hex Blast, try and target the middle Blood Witch that's barely within range. I decided to target her because the AoE will catch 3 instead of just 2, so I want to try and capture everybody, or as many people as possible. So I boost a hit, I hit the central target, and I do end up clipping 2 more. So I kill the one that I hit, and then only one's within range of Vociferin's soul-collecting ability. anyways, but I just want to start chipping away at his numbers. So blast damage fails to kill the closest one, but kills the other two. After that, I activate the Bane Riders and have them run up. What I want to try and do with the Bane Riders is have them take on the Bane Knights later in the game, and I plan to try and do that using impact attacks. Once the Bane Knights move into the forest, try and target one of the ones that are a little further back. That way, I can hit more than one at a time with impact attacks. And then DJ advances and casts Second Touch on Cankerworm just to help kill the objective on the next turn. Once Death Jack's done, the Reaper activates and he runs up just to get within 4 inches of Field Catch, which is my objective, to get that free charge off. Then I activate Ornn Midwinter, who runs to get cover behind the near obstacle, and Saxon Orc, who runs to the hill.
So I was a little surprised that my opponent moved Vociferon up so aggressively to get rid of a few of my Blood Witches, but I'm actually quite happy about that. The first thing I'm thinking is that it's going to be close, but I think I can actually just have a Biothrall walk up there and purge him. I mean, you know, a Power 12 may just kill him, so that's what I'm going to do first. Also, Hellbound, just by the way, is upkept for free by the Wither Shadow Combine. So right now I'm moving my Biothralls up, hoping that Vociferon is within that 6 inches. It's going to be really close, so let's see what happens. I measure that, then we use a spray for accuracy, and we determine he's just out, so that's a dead Biothrall. But that's fine, I still have my Satixus Blood Witches in play. So right now what I'm doing is I'm charging with the front one right there, and I'm going to run with another one to achieve that gang bonus. So, you know, that will make the Mat 8 and POW 12, which I'm thinking should do the job if it doesn't have another attack. Now I'm moving the rest of my Blood Witches in between the objective and the deep water, and basically right here I'm just trying to create space. I'm trying to create an area that he can't run his Satixus Raiders past. Rolling now damage on Vociferon, I roll pretty high and one-shot him, so that's one less arc node I need to worry about. Next, it looks like I'm going with my Bane Knights. I know I'm going to sound like a broken record because I keep mentioning this, but I love putting one Bane Knight, you know, within that 3 inches so the opponent can, you know, maybe charge him just to vengeance my other ones out of there. So that's what I'm positioning for right now. Again, the Helldiver is just burrowing. He's like a ticking time bomb, getting closer and closer to Gaspy 3 for that headbutt. Tartarus is going into range to maybe curse something in the zone next round, but really I'm just putting him behind that forest to keep him safe. Right now, moving Gaspy, I decide against that, so I move him back, and again, I'm putting down 3 Caustic Mist Clouds, which will leave me on 1. And again, the goal here is not to block line of sight, although that's always a good thing. And you know, if this was Signar or something, it'd be crucial to block line of sight to my Biothralls. But really, I want to just take up as much of this zone as possible. His force is really, really quicker than me. You know, Satixus Raiders run up to 16 inches, so I'm really just trying to occupy the zone before he can get there. After I put my Mist Clouds down, moving my Bane Thralls, and, you know, again, using one of them to kind of clog up that hole between the objective and the Caustic Mist Clouds, and moving the rest of them in charge range in case he puts something like Death Jack or the Ogryn Bakor into the zone next turn. After that, I'm moving my Death Ripper a little forward, just hoping that I can get that Excarnate off next turn. And then finally, I'm moving Daragraith, and again, since he doesn't have living models, I'm just doing Death Ride, just to reposition my troops a little bit. With a Shadow Combine, I'm kind of hanging out in the back. I'm actually backing up my Bane Knights a little bit, just because I guess I'm feeling a little insecure about where they are. I'm just trying to keep them safe. I mean, unlike Bane Thralls, they don't have stealth, so it's really scary if someone can get a bunch of shots off of them. And then I pass it over to my opponent.
For Asphyxia's turn 2, I think about it for a moment, but I upkeep Ashen Veil Narrators, since I do plan to charge the objective this turn with them. I just gotta figure out how to get rid of the two Blood Witches who are under a mini feat, which is gives them incorporeal for a round. Deal with them, and then I'll have an easier time, but I feel I can adequately clear out the zone this turn. So I move the Reaper first, he goes into a cloud, takes point damage, and then he attacks the Bane Thrall with his reach attack. He hits the Bane Thrall, but unfortunately the Bane Thrall makes his tough check. Then I go ahead and check to see if Deathjack is within the 4 inches of the field catch to get a free charge, just because it's nice to know. But I end up using just casting a Bone Shaker with him to try and kill the Blood Witch, and unfortunately I miss, so Deathjack just moves up to get closer and closer. I wanted to try and dominate the zone this turn, so I'm creating like a little steel wall with my two Heavy Jacks so Asphyxius can hide behind them, as well as get tucked into the objective. Then I go ahead and try and figure out how I'm going to get to the rest of the Bane Thralls behind the clouds. I feel I can get there, I know, I think I can, I just want to make sure that I have what I think is actually going to happen can actually happen. So after doing some further deliberation, I go ahead and check to see which of the Bane Knights that I can see. Because I know the front one is really just a bait to give the unit vengeance. And I'm pretty determined that I'm not going to go ahead and attack him. I'll maybe give him a couple Bane Riders just to slow his advance. But I really just want to advance the one Bane Rider that I move first, so he can get his reach attack on the Bane Thrall's knockdown. I throw another one up there, and then I go ahead and feed two more and leave two further back, or feed one more and leave two back. So I attack the Bane Thralls on the ground, auto hits, but I roll Snake Eyes and fail to break armor, so I do not force another tough check, which is really going to be annoying because I'm not sure how I'm going to deal with him at this point. But I'm already committed to my plan. So then after the Bane Riders are done, I activate Orin Midwinter, who moves, shuffles forward and casts Chain Lightning at the Blood Raiders. I think it's Chain Lightning, I can't remember what it's called. But he hits them and arcs to the second one, and it kills both Blood Witches. And then once Orin is done, Kinkorm activates. And I'm being skeptical because I'm thinking if I want to activate Asphyxius first to cast mobility, but I end up just moving Cankerworm his full 6 inches into a cloud, takes point damage, and he begins swinging on the one Bane Thrall that is probably going to be the hardest for anyone else to get to. So I do kill him. I miss the first attack, but the second attack kills him. And then because Kinkworm's got affinity with Asphyxius, he gets a free move after he's done activated, and I move him to my opponent's side of the zone, that way my opponent has a tougher time getting models into the zone. Then I activate the Raiders, and they take the order of the charge. I know my opponent is going to want to get his Excarnate Bomb off, so I'm intentionally going to only charge in half of them. I'm going to try and use the first three to get rid of these two more Bane Thralls who are in the zone, and then the second grouping of three is going to go onto the objective. And then I'm going to try and keep the mini feet back so I don't, because I don't want to use it yet. So the Raiders, the first few, they're able to take care of the two Bane Thralls that are within range. I killed one first one, second one toughed, but the second attack on the second one killed him, which allowed everyone else to throw their attacks into the objective. Actually, I throw into objective, and even being at pound 9, they still barely kill it. Then once the Raiders are done, I'm trying to, I'm just looking at my opponent's side of the board, trying to see where he's going to make his next movements to. and I just activate the Bakor, who's a little more expendable this game. He just runs forward, takes his damage from the cloud, and tries to plug up the zone so my opponent can't put as many models in the zone again. And Asphyxius activates. Because I'm not too comfortable, I was able to get... I left two Bane Thralls in the zone, and I don't, and I'm pretty sure I can't get them at this point. So I go ahead and advance Asphyxius. I don't cast any spells, I just want to get him a little closer, that way he can just do a basic advance to get him to dominate the zone next turn. And I go ahead and run Gorman. Or not run Gorman, but advance him into the smoke cloud.
So my opponent's last turn was actually really formative for me in the fact that he really showed his hand in, you know, what he's trying to accomplish. It's no secret that Gatsby 3 is an amazing jam caster and likes to play for scenario, and now that I know that's exactly what he's doing, I can kind of formulate a plan to prevent that. So in this turn, what I'm thinking is that I want to get as much attritional advantage as I can on him and kind of flood the zone with enough bodies that it's hard for him to take them all out next turn and dominate, but also give him a tempt in place to put Gatsby 3 so I can potentially assassinate him on my turn 4. Another thing to note is that he also committed 6 Satixus Raiders into the zone to kill that objective, which means I have a great Excarnate target if everything goes well. The Ogryn Bokor and the Cankerworm kind of jamming it is a big problem for me, but, you know, that's what Weapon Masters are for, and luckily I got them in abundance. So right now, Gatsby's measuring his control area, and I'm thinking about orders of activations. One rule that I don't see used enough for Gatsby 2 is he can basically throw a spear and it turns into an AoE that collects souls when people die. This is a crucial rule in playing him well, because once you get that soul train going, you can keep it going turn after turn, most likely. And I mean, an extra death now, an extra parasite, a few extra caustic mist clouds, that would probably win you the game. You know, focusing the bank is always a great thing. So right now it looks like I decided not to activate Gatsby, and I'm going to try to clear up some of the jam as well as put some damage on his Warjacks. I don't expect to kill his Warjacks right here, but I do want to damage them a bit, so basically the intent here is that, you know, once I feat, I'll be able to take out a bunch of his stuff all in one fell swoop. Got a little careless with my charge right now, so it looks like that, you know, one of my Bane Thralls took a free strike. Rolling the tough check, it died. The other one managed to be safe, not by any doing on my part. I just kind of lucked out on that one. And now I'm sending the rest of them into that Ogryn Bokor with the intent to kill it so I can unjam my Bio Thralls. You know, this is a pretty important charge, because like I said, the results are tremendous in that if I kill the Ogryn Bokor, it allows me to get a huge purge off, so we're being very precise about that. So let's see if I can get the job done with 3 Bane Thralls on this guy. My other 2 Bane Thralls charge Cankerworm, and my standard bearer just runs forward, staying back, just because, you know, if he ends up killing him, I lose tough, which is a huge defensive mechanic for them. Looks like I only needed one of them. 2 axes got the job done, so I'm just kind of going down the line, rolling on Cankerworm now. He's actually really hard to hit. Looks like I miss all 3 on them, rolling on Deathjack. Hit once on him. Damage isn't super high, but like I said, I'm not looking to kill him, just trying to get some additional damage on there. Second one misses. So one thing that I probably could have done better here is I could have moved Tartarus up just in the range to either curse Cankerworm or Deathjack. That extra 2 to hit is really a big deal, and you know, upon watching this video again, it's something that I probably should have done that I didn't do. But you know, you live, you learn. So now that I've cleared the Ogryn Bokor, I'm kind of thinking again about my orders of activations just to make sure I don't mess up this purge. So Gatsby's going right now, showing my opponent where I'm going to put that cloud. It does cover all six of them, so if I get a purge on six of them, I end up with six extra focus next turn, which is a huge amount. I'm also placing my caustic mist clouds down to stop the rest of the raiders from charging through. They're not actually where they are, it's just it was really hard to, you know, kind of position them on top of the models without disrupting the game state. So we're just kind of, I'm showing my opponent where I want them to be, and we're just kind of ignoring them for now. The one in the zone is actually in the zone, though. It's in its correct place. So in order to prepare for the purge, I'm getting two of my Blood Witches out of the way. I'm deciding to attack with the other one. I roll pretty high, so I hit it, and I kill it. I get a soul, and now I'm thinking about which ability I want to use. I'm going to use the Blood Mist ability to roll damage on that to see if I can kill him. Doesn't quite work. And now it's time for the purge. So I'm moving my Biothrall forward. I'm trying to make sure that the line of sight gets as much of his guys as possible while minimizing the damage on my guys. I go to purge. I'm about moving the rest of them, of course. And then I go to purge, measuring to 6 inches. And oh, look, I forgot about melee ranges. So purge is a ranged attack. I'm engaged, and he basically can't purge. All of that set up for nothing, but hey, it happens. So I still want to get as many souls as possible right now, so now I'm moving my two Wart Sirens into play to try to spray those raiders down. Spray is a magic attack, so they're not affected by force barrier, so I need sevens to hit, so you know, hopefully I kill about half of them there. It looks like I did pretty well with the first spray. I'm doing the second spray right now. Gonna hit my own guy. He's just dead, and then I'm gonna go after the other ones. Let's see what I got. Missed that one, and I missed the other one. Still though, three souls is pretty good. You know, I'm not complaining. Now I'm operating Derek Wraith, and I'm just using Death Ride to kind of get my Bane Knights into more advantageous positions for the charge. Also moving Tartarus out of the way a little bit. So yeah, that's what I'm doing right now. Alright, and then he just like calves away a teeny little bit. Tartarus goes forward and curses the Death Jack, which again, that's what I should have done earlier. Right now we're just doing a little bit of housekeeping, so since, you know, three of the raiders are dead now, I'm moving my clouds back to where they actually should be. And, you know, it's just something nice to do because my opponent may be, you know, thinking about what he's going to do during his turn, so you always want the game state to be as accurate as possible. So, you know, it's just being considerate at that point. Right now I'm charging two Bane Knights into Death Jack. It looks like they've reached so they can actually charge past the, or reach past the Bane Thralls. It looks like I probably got three of them in, and the rest of them I'm charging into his Bane Riders. Now, one thing that I was a little disappointed about last round was that my opponent didn't take the bait and kill that Bane Knight, so I got no juicy vengeance targets, but hey, he's a good player, so what can you expect? So just going down the line, attacking Deathjack, I hit. Let's see how much damage I roll. Again, it's a little below average, but it's fine. The next one's pretty high, so it kind of makes up for it. And then my third one looks like it hits, and then some more damage onto Deathjack. So he's pretty beat up at this point, which is great. Going to my Bane Riders, the first one misses. Looks like the second one misses. Third one hits, but it's pretty low actually, so it's not dead. That one cranks the damage to kill that one, and the last one hits, and again, does enough damage to kill that one. So 2 out of 3 ain't bad, you know, I'll live with that. moving my Wither Shadow Combine up and taking a few pot shots at the objective. I'm not expecting much here, but you know, maybe I'll roll high and put some damage on it, which will help me kind of take hold of it next round to potentially dominate or control that zone. And then I just back my Death Ripper up just because there's nothing for him to do.
Alright, so I got lucky this turn. My opponent advanced a Biothrall into reach range, so I prevented him from purging because of that. So that's probably the biggest thing from my opponent's turn. I elect not to upkeep Ashen Veil, as I am feeling confident I'm able to clear the zone this turn. He's got my opponent's bunched up his models. Gorman's going to be able to acid bomb and kill 4 out of 5 at least. Cankerworm just has to kill one Bane Thrall, and then the 3 Raiders have to kill another Bane Thrall, and then my opponent is not in the zone at all. So that should be 3 points right there. I'm going to use my feet this turn, so I just get to it. I activate Asphyxius, he moves up first, cast 3 for Carnage to get additional melee buff to hit buff. Pops his feet, then Gorman goes to work. He's immune to corrosion, so he can go into the cloud without damage. Then he throws an acid bomb into the middle of my opponent's models. It deviates only slightly, getting closer to Deathjack, but not touching him, and it hits all 5 of my opponent's models. And then I proceed to, or it hits Deathjack, no damage. I proceed to roll damage for all 5 of my opponent's models. It fails to kill any of the Bane Knights, but it does kill both Bane Thralls, so it kills 2 out of 5, which is a lot lower than I was expecting. And once Gorman's done, I go ahead and activate the Raiders. They advance out of the cloud so they don't take damage and die. And then I get the next grouping of Raiders ready. And the Raiders proceed to try and kill the Bane Thrall, Officer Yue. So the first one goes by herself, misses both swings, then I CMA the remaining 2, and the result is doing 4 points of damage to the Bane Thrall officer, leaving him alive. And at the time I didn't realize that I didn't have any other way of killing him, so that really put me in a bind right there. I continue with the show. I need to wipe out all the Bane Knights this turn if I'm to have a chance. So Death Check activates, shuffles forward a little bit because I don't want to get too close, and then he uses all his base attacks to kill the 3 Bane Knights that are in front of them. Once Death Check's done, I activate the Bane Riders. My opponent has the Bane Knights kind of clumped up, so I'm thinking I might be able to do some damage, especially if the impact attacks. So I go ahead and take the order of charge, and I kill at least one Bane Knight at the first impact attack and the second one. So I was like, all right, things are looking better at this point in time. And then the second Bane Rider charges and fails to kill a Bane Knight, who's not his charge target, with the impact attack. But I still managed to take out total 4 Bane Knights with the 3 Riders, so I'm happy. My opponent only has 2 Bane Knights left, so Vengeance is not going to be too much of a concern. Then it's Cankerworm's turn. So I was thinking if there's any way Cankerworm can get to officer, which he can't, so he ends up just attacking the other one that's in the zone and killing another Bane Thrall, and just trying to advance in a place of general annoyance to shut down my opponent doing the Vile Thrall purge trick. And then the Raider captain runs because I didn't lose track of the Helldiver. I was just hoping I'd be able to really dominate the zone, which would have shut down my opponent somewhat, or forced them to play slightly differently. But hindsight's 20/20. So I activate the Reaper. I have him advance a little more, try and, at this point, get rid of one of the two remaining Bane Knights, and he does successfully. Then I have activate Orin Midwinter, have him advance up, and then he casts Null Magic to prevent my opponent from doing spells, because I really don't want to get caught with Parasite.
There's no greater feeling than getting your Helldiver in range to headbutt a caster when you're playing Gatsby 2. There's also no worse feeling getting that Helldiver in range and then missing the boosted attack roll. But, you know, let's see what happens. First, I'm doing my Vengeance with my one last Bane Knight. It looks like he's good, and he ends up taking out a Bane Rider, which is pretty good. You know, he's punching above his weight class, which is what I like to see. Right now, I'm trying to figure out the best place to put my Helldiver, and probably I'm going to measure the control range. You always want to make sure you can allocate focus. And what's going to help me out here is that extra 3 focus that I got from last turn killing those Satixus Raiders. You know, each focus is pretty valuable, and now that Gatsby has so much, we'll let him allocate some, as well as get involved and hopefully wreck some jacks. So let's see what happens. So the very first thing I want to do is move in Dara Grafe and move in my Wither Shadow Combine into a more advantageous position to potentially charge some of those jacks. I also was able to move Gatsby so he's not directly behind the wall. He does not have Pathfinder, so if I want to charge with him, he can't be obstructed by a linear obstacle. Kind of moving around the rest of my troops right here, and then light cavin him out of the way. I'm measuring Gatsby now just to make sure that he is in charge range of the two jacks, just because, you know, if he's not, my assassination run kind of goes out the window, so I'd have to change course. So right now I have 2 options. You know, I can just get the Helldiver out of the way, but it looks like I'm actually operating the Wither Shadow Combine right now, and because Tartarus is in the way, I can't get all 3 on the Reaper. It would be amazing. I've actually never built a jack from the Wither Shadow, and it would be great to do it on video, but, you know, today is just not the day. Looks like the first one hit, did a good amount of damage to Deathjack, and then the other 2 are now swinging on the Reaper. I believe they're at 6, so it looks like the first one missed, second one hit, and again, that's a whole lot of damage on that Reaper. Next, I'm just getting out of the way. You know, probably the most important role of the game right here is spending 1 for the headbutt, spending 1 to boost, needing a 9. I got it. Gatsby's knocked down, which is great. Seeing if I do a little bit of damage on him, double 1s, doesn't matter that much. Right now, it looks like I'm asking about the damage grids on both of the jacks, and removing the Caustic Mist Clouds. They are not upkeeps, and we forgot to remove them, so just cleaning up the board a little bit. Next, I'm moving my Warwitch Sirens into play, trying to spray off the Satixus Raiders who are currently jamming the Bane Thralls I have in play. Looks like I hit one, the other one's kind of stuck in place, so let's see what happens here. Second one's going up to spray between the 2 Bane Thralls. Looks like I actually clip him and kill him. That's not good. Let's see if I hit the Raider, and I missed the Raider. So one good thing about being able to headbutt Gatsby is it actually frees up Tartarus to curse one of the jacks. Gatsby is only a mat 6 or 7, I can't remember off the top of my head, but it's pretty low actually for a Warcaster. You know, he's no Xerxes or Butcher, so getting any amount of extra 2 hit buffs on the defense 13 jacks is great. Looks like Tartarus cursed Deathjack and then went in and took a swing on the Reaper, hit him pretty easily, and killed him. And now, if I'm not mistaken, I think it's time for Gatsby to go in and get some work done. Yep, there we go. Elitch is charging. He's taking a free strike from his own character, Jack, Cankerworm. He's camping a ton of focus right now, though, so it doesn't hurt him. And now he's going to start swinging. Looks like it hits. Doing a bit of damage. Not quite dead. Buying another attack. Boosting, of course, just to make sure. Hits. And I believe he's pretty low, so this one just kills him. Now I attempt a Parasite Gatsby 3, but little did I know, I forgot that Orin Midwinter casted as no magic, so I can't cast Parasite and I can't teleport out. So, you know, it's do or die right now. Although I'm feeling pretty good about this, but let's see how it goes. Right now I've just feated, which means I'm putting on the board 9 Bane Knights and 1 Bane Thrall. That's usually the combination you want to go with, just because you want to get that Dark Shroud bonus from the Bane Thrall, and you want to utilize the Bane Knights. In this situation, I guess I was a little lucky and it happened that I had, you know, 9 Bane Knights dead. There have been situations, though, where I'll kill my own Bane Knights in order to feat with them if you know, that seems to be the best strategy right now. One thing I'm trying to consider is I'm trying to put the Bane Knights and Bane Thralls around Gatsby in that 3 inches in a way that won't hinder them from charging, you know, just to make sure that I can get as many bodies onto Gatsby 3 as possible. Looks like I'm pretty happy with that right here. So you know, now I'm just moving my other models, just trying to see how much damage I can do in case, you know, something goes wrong. Just, you know, just so I know what the board will look like in case defeat doesn't go well. I did a gang attack with my Blood Witches. I tried to use the strength blood dagger thing to kill Gorman, didn't work, and then I attacked with my Hag and killed another Zatixis Raider. Now I'm moving my Bane Thralls into Cankerworm. Looks like I tried to fit one of them in between the two Biothalls, but there wasn't enough space. Rolling on the other ones. And, you know, Cankerworm has such a resilient grid. It's one of my favorite grids in the game, so obviously I'm not going to kill him with only a couple Weapon Master attacks. So here we go. First, you know, move in with my Bane Thrall, just to kind of get that Dark Shroud in place. I roll bananas, which is really good. Next, I'm moving with the one Bane Knight that wasn't in feat. Basically, what we're doing is I'm trying to get it into range to kill that objective, just to free up some more space and some more charge vectors. Looks like I hit and, you know, do a lot of damage on the objective. I believe it has a few left, so now I'm going to start activating my feat models. You know, activate the first Bane Knight, put it at maximum reach range, and that does enough damage to kill it. So again, you know, we're just trying to be really sure about these moves being as accurate as possible, just because this is a potentially game-winning play, so we want to make sure that I have the reach and that I have moved the 3 inches for the charge dice. It looks like we're good to go. Taking a roll on him, and let's see if it's enough. And that's another really high damage, so that's a win for Gatsby 2. Thank you guys so much for watching this game, for watching Advanced Maneuvers, and we'll see you next week.